Hi, we are going to talk about large bowel obstruction. Okay, so first we want to talk about the causes of large bowel obstruction. See, bowels, there are two, that is the small bowel and the large bowel. There are specific causes for obstruction of small bowel. The specific causes for obstruction of large bowel. So today we are going to discuss about large bowel obstruction. One of the common causes are diverticulitis. These objects that you see over here, they are diverticula. Now, whenever there is an inflammation inside these diverticula, it causes a paracolic inflammatory process. This paracolic inflammatory process causes fibrosis of the intestinal walls. Now imagine this inflammatory process happening over and over again. So when this inflammatory process happens over and over again, an acute diverticulitis changes into a chronic diverticulitis, so more fibrosis and stricture formation, which causes an obstruction. So, if you read the blue box over here, diverticulosis causes chronic pericolic inflammation, which causes the fibrosis of colon wall, ultimately leads to stricture formation and obstruction. Now, if there is a stricture formation inside the colon wall, then you have to rule out malignancy because malignancy also presents as a stricture formation. One of the form of malignancies is stricture formation. Intussusception is rare in adults, but in children, intussusception is one of the main causes of large bowel obstruction, but not in adults. Look at this picture over here. This is a sigmoid colon volvulus. The way we know that it's a sigmoid colon is because if you take an X-ray, the dilated part points towards right upper quadrant. So sigmoid colon twist around this mesentery, so there's a mesentery over here, and this sigmoid colon twists around the mesentery, which results in a closed loop, which means there's one loop and both the ends come together. The proximal colon dilates while the rectum empties. The rectum, there's no obstruction to the rectum, but the proximal colon slowly, slowly dilates. So there's an obstruction over here, the proximal colon has dilated. Next, we look at acecal volvulus. Acecal volvulus happens due to inadequate fixation of the cecum, so cecum rotates and causes a picture like this. The most common cause of a large bowel obstruction is actually adenocarcinoma, because adenocarcinoma accounts for majority of large bowel obstruction. As you can see, it's written in the box. If you can see this picture, this adenocarcinoma, this carcinomata changes from the wall, has almost obstructed the lumen. There's a small lumen available for the passage of stool. Otherwise, after some time, if the cancer continues to grow, there's going to be a complete obliteration of the lumen. In this box, you can see certain causes. Let's go through them one by one. Neoplasms we talked about, most common causes. Then volvulus also we discussed, inflammatory mediated diverticulitis, chronic stricture, Crohn's disease, radiation, Crohn's disease, these all causes fibrosis, ultimately leading to stricture formation, hernia if it is a strangulated hernia, intussusception. There is another cause called as adynamic cause, which includes paralytic ileus, which means that there is a problem in the motility. And another syndrome is called Ogilvie's syndrome. Ogilvie's syndrome, we can pronounce it in other way, Ogilvie's syndrome. It's a proper noun, so it depends on how you want to pronounce it. So if you look at the CT scan, there is a dilatation of the cecum with proximal part of the transverse colon. There is no actual mechanical obstruction to cause this kind of dilatation. There is actually a neural problem. The exact etiology is not known. Could be infective, could be medicinal causes, but there is an entity which is very similar to paralytic ileus, some motility disorder, and this is called as Ogilvie's syndrome. Next comes something called as ischemic stricture, foreign body, and fecal impaction. Fecal impaction is this hard stool present mostly on the left side, because on the left side you have got a harder stool on the left on the compared to the right side. Right side you have got softer stool. Foreign body can be present. Ischemic stricture also can cause obstruction, large bowel obstruction. What happens when there is a large bowel obstruction? So whenever there is a large bowel obstruction, there is a point in the bowel which is constricted, all right? That means that part is not allowing the stuff which is behind it to pass through that area so that it can pass through the anal in return. So all those stuff is stuck over there, okay, which is proximal to the obstruction. So there is accumulation of gas, there is accumulation of intestinal contents, fluids proximal to the obstruction. So whenever these stuff get accumulated, slowly the colon starts to swell up, you know, so they start expanding. So and they say, all right, we have stuff coming in, we have got to expand. So this causes severe distension, and after some time they just can't distend anymore, and that is when the walls become thin and they perforate. This is where ileocecal valve's importance come into the picture. Ileocecal valve, what it does is, if ileocecal valve relaxes, then some of those stuff which is getting stored up in the colon can actually pass through the valve and relieve the obstruction a little bit and help out. But if ileocecal valve is patent, which means if ileocecal valve is acting very well, then you can understand that the stuff which is already stored up inside the distended colon does not pass through the ileocecal valve and worsens the situation. So slowly, because of distension, after some time what is going to happen is the blood supply is going to get cut off. So when blood supply gets cuts off, there is intestinal necrosis, and when intestinal necrosis happens, it is life threatening. But there's a good thing about not a good thing per se, but compared to small bowel obstruction, large bowel obstruction is milder. Dehydration is very slow, because what happens is colon has this ability. One of the functions of colon is to absorb fluids. Okay, so colon has this ability to absorb its fluid content. So colon can self-sustain itself compared to small bowel obstruction. If there's small bowel obstruction, small bowel cannot absorb any fluid content, because of which a small bowel obstruction is more severe compared to a large bowel obstruction. And distension capacity of the colon is also more. Okay, so as you can see over here, that there's an ileocecal valve present over here. If ileocecal valve is non-competent, it allows some of the stuff to flow back. As you can see, there is dilated small intestine. It has, in this situation, some of the stuff has gone back into the small intestine. But if ileocecal valve is competent, then that stuff does not go back. And the cecum gets beaten up more. So bowel distends with fecal matter, and you can see there is dilatation of colon. In this picture, you can see there is perforation which has happened. We talked about that fact that when the bowel keeps stretching to let this stuff getting stored in, you know, to so that it gets stored in, and bowel has the ability to sustain, so it keeps stretching, but after some time it just gives way and perforation happens, and when blood supply is cut off, it gives rise to ischemia and ultimately necrosis of the bowel. which is an emergency. Now, what
Okay.
about the clinical manifestations? How does the patient present to us when large bowel obstruction happens? As I said, the large bowel obstruction symptoms are not as severe as small bowel obstruction symptoms because they can absorb fluid and the distension capacity is more. So symptoms in large bowel obstruction progresses more slowly compared to small bowel obstruction. Now, depends on where the obstruction is, you'll get different kind of symptoms. That is, if this obstruction is at rectum or sigmoid colon, then constipation may be the only symptom for months. Okay. A patient also presents with abdominal distension because you see the bowel loops are swelling up. Okay, and because these are large bowel is present more commonly on the sides compared to small bowels. Small bowels are present more in the middle. So abdominal distension is more on the flanks compared to the abdomen, but most of the cases, if you see, it's a generalized distension. And slowly, slowly, when the loops of intestine becomes more and more enlarged, you'll be able to see the outline of the loops of intestine through the abdominal wall. And the patient develops abdominal pain, and finally, after some time, patient develops fecal vomiting. Okay. Fecal vomiting means it's not really feces, it's mostly the bacteria which is getting stored up over there due to stasis. This bacteria degrades biologically the stuff which is already present inside the colon, and ultimately those stuff come out. And signs of shock may also be present if it leads to a perforation. A perforation will give rise to signs of shock. Okay, hemodynamic instability is going to be present in the patient. Now, what are the investigations that you do? How do you know that there is an obstruction present? Okay, so a good investigation is x-ray. If you do an x-ray, it's cheaper compared to CT scan or MRI scan. An x-ray will give you a fair amount idea that whether it is a small bowel obstruction or a large bowel obstruction. You know how a bowel obstruction presents. A patient comes with abdominal distension, vomiting, constipation or obstipation. Obstipation is that he does not pass any gas or any stool. Okay, all these are the symptoms which are present. So if you look at the x-ray, there is a chance that you might get confused between a large or small bowel obstruction. So there are methods to differentiate between a large and a small bowel obstruction. So on the left side are the features of a large bowel obstruction. If you look at the loops, they are more peripheral, which means the central stuff is kind of empty compared to the loops which are dilated with air, which is darker compared to any other structure present around in the vicinity. So the large bowel loops are most peripheral compared to small bowel loops, which are actually more central. Okay, if you recall your basic anatomy, and large bowel is fewer in number. You can see that there's just a few loop over here. It's just this much, all right, and have diameter which is greater than 5 centimeter. Okay, now this is about 5 centimeter diameter. They contain feces and have haustral margins that do not extend across the bowel lumen. Okay, now look at these haustral margins. These are haustral margins. These small white lines. These small white lines are actually haustral margins. And these haustral margins do not extend across the bowel lumen. That is in large bowel. This point is very important because this is a very differentiating feature between a large bowel and a small bowel. If you look at the small bowel x-ray, you see that the loops are more central, as I already said. They're multiple between 3 and 5 centimeter, which means the diameter is not as much as the large bowel. Look at the diameter over here. Okay, and look at the diameter over here. Diameter of small bowels, they're multiple in number. Can you see? Multiple in number, more central, more peripheral. There's something called as, and they do not contain feces. Feces don't form over here. Feces form in the colon. Now there's something called as valvulae coniventis. Valvulae coniventis is a feature in which you will see in jejunal loops. In this If you know what valvular comitantus is, it will be very evident to you that these are present everywhere. Okay, these are like slightly opaque lines which extend across the bowel lumen. And the seen in jejunal loops, these are features of jejunal loops. Now here is another picture differentiating a large bowel and small bowel. It's a very good picture. In large bowel, you have hostrae. Okay, they do not transverse the bowel. If you look at these are the hostrae. They start over here and they end over here. They're not transversing the whole bowel. But here in small bowel, you have got valvulae coniventes. Okay, so look how where they start. They start over here. They extend across the bowel lumen. Next, a CT scan. A CT scan or an MRI scan is very helpful. A CT scan is more rapid compared to an MRI scan, but in CT scan, you have got radiation exposure compared to MRI. So whichever situation is better, you can actually perform. Okay. So in CT scan, what happens is you can it's the diagnosis. You get a more accurate diagnosis using CT scan compared to an X-ray. And I've written over here, a CT is more accurate in diagnosing the cause of enema. I'm extremely sorry about that. It's not enema, it's actually diagnosing the cause of the obstruction and is widely available and rapid. What I was trying to do over there is because I was trying to compare CT scan with enema. Initially, barium enema used to be performed to find out the place where obstruction is, but it's not done anymore so routinely other than special circumstances. CT scan is more common, and over here you can see the picture. Hepatic flexure stricture is present, so it's an accurate diagnosis, and you can localize where the diagnosis is present. And sometimes in MRI, if you see bowel wall thickening, MRI picture. This is an MRI picture on the right side, so you can see bowel wall thickening over here. Those also can be seen. Those features also can be seen. Now, what happens is. Adenocarcinoma is, as I said, is one of the major causes of obstruction. So most of the adenocarcinoma occur beyond the splenic flexure, therefore are accessible via sigmoidoscopy. So sigmoidoscopy is a good investigation. It's an invasive investigation, but sigmoidoscopy is always a good investigation. So if you do a sigmoidoscopy, because so it can travel through the sigmoid and ultimately end up visualizing the adenocarcinoma, okay, because it is present at beyond the splenic flexure. Okay, so most of the adenocarcinoma are in this area. So if you do a sigmoidoscopy, it's more accessible to you. Colonoscopy also can be done if sigmoidoscopy comes out negative. Okay, so the advantages of colonoscopy sigmoidoscopy is that you can actually take a biopsy for histopathological diagnosis, compared to just radiological examination. But radiological examination is also very important. And one more feature that I forgot to mention in case of radiological examination is that you can see any perforation is present. If there is any perforation, you will see gas under the diaphragm. Gas under the diaphragm is an important feature of perforation of the bowel wall. Okay, now what are the treatments? How do you treatment? The first important treatment that you have to consider is a conservative treatment. In conservative treatment, what happens? Because there is a lot of third space loss, there are a lot of fluids which are stored in the lumen. Colon is absorbing them, but not absorbing them in such a great rate as it's supposed to. So a lot of fluid is being lost in the lumen of the colon, and the patient is dehydrated. So the intravascular volume has to be treated, and even if there's shock, the intravascular volume has to be corrected. Correction of electrolyte abnormalities. These conditions are very much associated with the electrolyte abnormalities, as I said, because there's a lot of volume loss. Nasogastric aspiration and decompression is very important. Okay, so you will try to do that first. You will apply a nasogastric tube inside the patient and then try to aspirate the contents and decompress, so that will help and relieve the patient of the pain. And also monitor the urine output, that is hourly urine output, by catheterizing patient Foley's catheter, and that will help you to determine whether the patient is going into shock or not. Urine output is an indicator of shock. So what about the invasive treatments? Okay, see, colonoscopy is not only diagnostic, it is therapeutic. Okay, so initial invasive therapeutic modality when conservative management is no longer appropriate is colonoscopy. So what happens is, if you do a colonoscopy, you can decompress the colon and avoid colonic ischemia and cecal perforation. We are trying to prevent these kind of situations, ischemia, perforation. These are emergencies. You have to take the patient to the operation theater and start operating. But if you can prevent it, it is the best scenario possible. So to do that, we want to do a colonoscopy. What happens, colonoscopy, you can take a biopsy. It excludes a mechanical etiology of obstruction. To enter the colon in section wise, you just cannot put the scope in and just go to it. There are different kind of maneuvers present, you know, to actually make the scope go through the colon. But section wise, you go through the colon. First you go to sigmoid, then you go to descending, then go to transverse, then ascending, then cecum. Okay, so what happens as each and subsequent section of colon is entered, air is suctioned. So all this gas which is formed, this gas, first you will suction it out. That will relieve the distension, okay, and pain, whatever, suction to near collapse. And you will give negative suction, so the colonic wall is going to collapse. And after it gets collapsed, then you will advance the scope into the further gently. And liquid stool is also suctioned. It is a very effective procedure, and rectal, and after some time for effective drainage, if there is recurrence, then you can put rectal tube for continuous decompression. There are certain situations in which colonoscopy cannot be done, is contraindicated, is if there is perforation present, or you suspect that there could be perforation, or if there is peritonitis with peritoneal signs. Peritoneal signs are guarding rigidity with rebound tenderness, and also along with the shock is present. Myocardial infarction, and if the patient is not non-compliant for colonoscopy, in those situations you will not do a colonoscopy. So this is a picture showing a rectal tube which is present. This rectal tube has many orifices over here, as you can see. These orifices help in draining the rectum, which ultimately relieves the distension present in the colon. Now we'll move into a little more hardcore surgery. One topic is colostomy. Colostomy can be done to relieve obstruction. Now colostomy, there are many different types, many different indications. I'm going to do a separate lecture on colostomy later, but first I have put up something which is required for a large bowel obstruction. A large bowel obstruction, colostomy. What are the colostomy required? One is something called as loop colostomy. Okay, loop colostomy, as you can see in the picture, it is not, we have not divided the colon. We have just brought the colon outside as a loop, and then we have made an opening on the loop. Okay, so ultimately it will give us two lumens, as you can see the picture below. As you can see the picture below, it is done as an emergency procedure for any obstruction present in the left colon, sigmoid colon or rectum. So there is obstruction present on the left side, sigmoid colon or rectum. So bring out the loop, and so whatever stool is being there, whatever obstruction is there, that is going to be drained. And the sigmoid colon and rectum obstruction can be still be there, and that also the stuff which is in between the loop and the rectum, those stuff is also going to come out. So there are two lumens. One lumen is connected to the proximal, the other lumen goes distal. Okay, so distal, whatever stuff is stored up, comes out through one lumen. Proximal, whatever stuff is stored up, comes out through another lumen. Okay, so end colostomy is preferred when permanency is desired. Sometimes colostomy should be permanent. Loop colostomy is mostly temporary. After some time you are going to remove it and re-suture it back. Okay, But end colostomy is when you have to divide the bowel and keep a stump, and the other stump needs to come out through the skin. So end in the violet box I have written end ileostomy is pre-planned. Okay, it's not ileostomy. I was going to talk end colostomy. There's a mistake. Most common type of end colostomy is in the sigmoid colon. So what happens is this opening is placed halfway between the umbilicus and the iliac spine. So you can imagine where it is, okay? And on the left side, obviously, because sigmoid colon is on the left side. But whenever you're putting the bowel loop, you just don't put it on the skin. You want to make sure this bowel loop moves through the rectus muscle. Otherwise, what happens is there is parastomal hernia formation. But if you move the bowel loop through the rectus muscle, the rectus muscle acts like a guard so that there is no herniation through it. Okay, there is another treatment option. It's called as a cecostomy. In cecostomy, what happens, the cecum is dilated, okay, persistently dilated, greater than 10 to 12 centimeters. I talked about the large x-ray that to 5 centimeters is a normal dilatation. Imagine double its size, more than double, 12 centimeters. And endoscopic decompression is just not happening. So what happens is through a skin, you make an opening into the cecum and you put a drain. And that drain is called 20 French male cord drain. This drain is going to relieve the, take all the stuff which is there inside the cecum, and it's going to get it out of the cecum. And so the cecum actually goes from an over-distended state to a normal state. Next, we move on to a Hartmann's procedure. What is Hartmann's procedure? Hartmann was a deadly guy. He was a French surgeon, and he found out a lot of other procedures apart from intestinal procedures. Okay, so Hartmann's procedure is mostly done in case of a carcinoma, which is present in the rectosigmoid colon. Okay, and is causing an obstruction. So the surgical dissection of the rectosigmoid colon and closure of the rectal stump is done. Okay, so remains is the other end, and that is the other end of colon, and that other end of colon is brought out through an end colostomy. Okay, so it's basically used in resection of colorectal tumors. Left and right hemicolectomy. What is the difference between left hemicolectomy and the right hemicolectomy, and when are they done? See, on the picture on your left side is your left hemicolectomy. If there is a tumor or mass on the left colon, that part needs to be removed, and left hemicolectomy is preferred. Whenever you do left and right hemicolectomy due to a presence of mass, you want to use a technique called as no touch technique of Turnbull, in which the blood vessels will be ligated so that the tumor masses do not travel through the bloodstream into the surrounding structures and thus prevent seeding. So in the left hemicolectomy, you want to take out distal half of transverse colon, okay, the splenic flexure, descending colon, and the fixed upper part of the pelvic colon, not mobile. Anastomosis is done between the pelvic colon, that is the sigmoid colon, and the transverse colon. As you can see, let's move on to right hemicolectomy. In right hemicolectomy, what is going to happen? What are the structures which are going to be removed? The 6 centimeter of terminal ileum is going to be removed. Actually, if you look at various textbooks, some say 5 centimeters, some say 8 centimeters, some say 10 to 12 centimeter of terminal ileum. But presently, it's 6 centimeter of terminal ileum. Cecum, appendix, ascending colon, right colic flexure, right half of transverse colon are removed. What about the arteries? Ileocolic arteries supplying the ileum, the right colic artery supplying the cecum, ascending colon, the right branch of middle colic artery supplying the proximal part, the transverse colon. Iliotransverse anastomosis is done to maintain gut continuity, that is ileum, the part which is remaining, is joined with the transverse colon part which is remaining as an end-to-end anastomosis. You have to remember that whenever you do a right hemicolectomy, you have to protect the duodenum protect the ureter and the gonadal vessels which process underneath the colon. Thank you so much. Please comment and like the video, and also stuff what you don't like also you can put up. And please visit the link that is shown over here for other videos.